In my last video, I showed the 24/7, my 3D printer prototype back from 2020, conveyor print bed, automated doors, and a 3D printed frame. Now it's time to push it further and to put it to the test with major hardware upgrades, Clipper firmware, and both theoretical and real-world printing comparisons. Can it keep up with a modern Voron Trident on aluminium extrusions? Does my 3D printed concept have a future? Let's find it out! Here on 24/7 printing. Thanks to PCBWay for sponsoring today's video. PCBWay offers a wide range of services like CNC machining, sheet metal fabrication, 3D printing, injection molding, and of course PCB production. Getting a quote for your projects is easy. Upload a file of your design, specify the parameters, add additional information, kindly wait for the quick shipping, and you're ready to go. Check out the link below in order to go the PCBWay with your project. For those who haven't seen my last video on the 24/7, here's a quick recap. Check the video linked in the description for more details. The 24/7 is a prototype I designed and built in 2020 with some bold ideas. A conveyor belt for automated print ejection, automated doors for enclosed printing, and a mostly 3D printed frame. But the original setup had its challenges. Running on smoothieware, it lacked modern features like input shaping or pressure advance. Combined with a heavy X-axis, a bulky tool head, in a cantilevered bed, the printer struggled with ringing and ghosting, even at low speeds. With input shaping, you can measure the printer's resonances using an accelerometer. You can apply input shaping to reduce vibration and to improve print quality at way higher print speeds. To some extent, it also reveals just how much performance a printer can handle and therefore also its structural weaknesses. It can be used as a diagnostic tool, which also allows concept comparisons. In this video, I'll test the 24/7 with Clipper to see how it compares to modern machines like the Voron Trident or BamboLab X1 Carbon. And we'll discuss the potential for an improved version of the 24/7 with its 3D printed frame. Let me tell you beforehand, it's performing better than expected and there are plenty of interesting findings. With the Clipper installation, I also made some overdue hardware upgrades. The outdated MKS board was replaced with a Big Tree Tech Octopus board, which has plenty of stepper motor support for the conveyor and automated doors. All motors were upgraded to modern TMC2209 stepper drivers, and I switched the power supply from 12V to 24V. This boosts the performance while ensuring compatibility with modern accessories. Part cooling was another priority. I replaced the weak 12V 3010 fan with a powerful CPAP turbo cooling system that interfaces nicely with my old fan duct design. Quick win here saved a lot of time. And surprise, surprise, my old friend the BL Touch caused new issues after switching to 24V and the Octopus board. It kept resetting during prints, which can be destructive for the probe. After years of frustration with this device, I finally found a way to replace it with an inductive probe, which now triggers over the carbon fiber surface with a little trick I applied. I simply glued a thin steel sheet to the aluminum print bed. It seems like this solves these everlasting, presumably EMF problems for good. The Clipper installation itself went smoothly, thanks to nice documentations from Big Tree Tech, Voron and the community. However, using Clipper with Octoprint and OctoClipper was less enjoyable. To keep it short, I was reminded why Mainsail or Fluid are preferred for Clipper. For this video though, I stuck with Octoprint after troubleshooting everything to run reliably, but just like some time ago on my Fast 24/7 in 2021, I'll need to switch to Mainsail. The LDO Voron Trident 250 I built last year serves as an excellent reference for comparison. It's a modern do-it-yourself printer with a roughly comparable max build space as the 24/7, but built on a 2020 aluminium extrusion frame and using linear rails for its CorXY system. While its moving parts could be more lightweight for higher speeds and accelerations, it's widely regarded as kind of a golden standard for do-it-yourself CorXY 3D printers. The other contender is the BamboLab X1 Carbon. While it is inspired by Voron CorXY printers, it sets a benchmark for high-speed, high-quality, ready-built machines. But let me make clear, I'm not a fan of their plans concerning functional restrictions on their firmware. And I recommend, vote with your wallet and don't buy BamboLab at the moment. So, how does the 24/7 with its 3D printed frame and heavy tool head compare? This is where Clipper's input shaping, also known as resonance compensation, becomes an interesting diagnostic tool. By attaching an accelerometer to the toolhead, it measures vibrations on the X and Y axis, which are then compensated to reduce ringing and improve print quality. While BamboLab's lockdown firmware prevents us from analyzing its resonance data, we can still compare print speeds and results. For Clipper-enabled printers like the Trident and now the 24/7, the resonance graphs provide valuable insights into structural strength as well as limitations. I am not the expert on this, so if you have additional information or corrections, please leave a comment. On the x-axis, the 24/7 shows one pronounced peak at a rather low 60 Hz, compared to the Trident 70 Hz. The lower frequency and stronger response reflect the 24/7's heavier toolhead and the weaker 3D printed frame. With the recommended MZ V-Shaper applied, vibrations can be effectively reduced, but the maximum recommended acceleration is 10,700 mm/s², quite a bit below the Trident's recommended accelerations, and smoothing is higher. On the y-axis, we have a similar story. The 24/7's dominant resonance appears at around 46 Hz, also significantly lower than the Trident's dominant one at roughly 60 Hz. Combined with the higher power spectral density, this highlights the challenges of the 24/7's less rigid 3D printed frame. As all in all, the y-axis of the 24/7 moved here is actually lighter than the Trident rather heavy one. And yes, the Trident's graph for the y-axis looks like a mess, but I couldn't find solutions for that in time, even after completely reprinting and rebuilding the gantry. You will see though, doesn't really matter at practical printing. Nevertheless, the Trident's frame seems to provide superior rigidity, and even though the whole moved masses are even higher, it theoretically allows for higher acceleration at quality printing. In contrast, the 24/7's weaker 3D printed frame and even lower moving masses make it harder to achieve the same levels of stability and speed. But guess what? I'm still super intrigued about the results anyway, because I expected super messy graphs for the 24/7 and way worse results, as design and the build per se were not optimized for high accelerations back then. Yes, the 3D printed frame, as it is, clearly shows its weaknesses here, and it's good to have the status quo on paper. However, that was theory. Now let's put it to the test, which also brings some interesting findings. First, let's analyze acceleration versus ringing on both the 24/7 and the Trident. For this, I used a Clipper ringing tower and a macro that increases acceleration step by step, starting at 1500 mm/s² and going up to 7000 in 500 mm/s² increments. Each printer has the recommended input shapers activated for each axis. Even though its resonance graph for the y-axis is super messy, the Trident performed nearly flawlessly up to 7000 mm/s², showing almost no ringing except for a tiny hint on the y-axis at highest accelerations there. The 24/7, however, clearly struggles. Ringing became noticeable at just 3500 to 4000 mm/s², and that's quite untypical on both axes. Normally, the heavier y-axis produces ringing earlier. This inconsistency led me to suspect the cantilevered bed doing its own vibration game. So I printed sections of that ringing tower at the rear, the middle, and at the front of the print bed. In addition, I used exaggerated speeds and accelerations at BamboLab's ludicrous values. And bingo, the ringing increased drastically the farther the print was from the mounting point at the rear. This confirms the bed's mounting design is an additional limitation, depending on the location of the print area. I also ran some 3D Benchy print tests at various speeds. First at Orca Slicer's default settings for Borons, then at the X1 Carbon standard speed and cooling settings, and finally at the X1 Carbon's ludicrous mode, which scales both speed and accelerations to 166% by firmware, overriding the slicer settings for both speed, acceleration, and also layer times. The very safe Voron default settings are no challenge for both the Trident and the 24/7. Both benches came out without flaws. At X1 Carbon default speed settings, the Trident shows weaknesses concerning the cooling capabilities of the Stealth Burner, as layer time is reduced from 8 seconds to 4 seconds, exactly like on X1 Carbon, which, like expected, produces a nice 3D Benchy at its default settings. The 24/7 shows deformation and ringing at the X1 Carbon defaults, but the CPAP cooling does a good job at the bow. At ludicrous mode, the Trident did not finish, resulting in a layer shift. The curling due to overheating was too bad on the Banshee's bow. The 24/7 shows exaggerated ringing and deformation at ludicrous mode, but again, CPAP cooling is even up to this. The X1 Carbon handled this clearly better, but showed overheating on the bow, likely due to the Sunlu standard PLA used for all the prints, which is notoriously hard to cool in comparison to others. The results for the 24/7 are not too bad in this comparison, but for sure reflects the results of our theoretic tests. Clipper on the 24/7 was a success. It boosted performance and it helped to expose the limits of the status quo. As expected, the 3D printed frame and heavy Himera-based toolhead struggle against a Trident with aluminum frame. I have expected way worse. But is it worth it to keep that concept alive? Maybe, but we need more evaluation on that. A reinforced design, stronger parts, and a few creative tricks I have at hand could push a 3D printed frame much further than expected. The gantry and belt path also need major improvements, as back in 2020, when I made this, today's speed standards weren't even on the radar. The biggest and easiest fix, the cantilevered print bed. Improving the mounting to modern standards with a multi-axis mount like on the Trident would solve a lot of the additional ringing issues due to the displacement of the print area. But here's the real question, still not answered. What advantages, if any, are actually left for a 3D printed frame over aluminum extrusions? That's also an important topic I want to evaluate. There's more to this than you'd expect. Sounds like a plan for the upcoming video. Right? Like, share and subscribe to keep this project alive. And if you want to help make it happen, support me on Patreon. Thanks for being part of this journey. Servus and goodbye. Shout out to our gold supporters, Gatsby and Shulu.